Good morning. Good morning. Happy September. Can you believe it's already September? Oh my goodness. Where's the time gone? I thought it was 4th of July last weekend. Well, welcome to the First United Methodist Church of Roseville. I'm Pastor Angel, and I'm so glad that you have chosen to worship here today, to be in community as we sing our praises, as we lift up our voices in prayer, and today as we celebrate Holy Communion, which, again, for those who might be new, is open to everyone. Bread, cup, everyone. Children, young, old, attend church every week, or this is your first time in many, 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 many weeks, you're welcome here. Nancy Bolanzano is out of town. Her husband's mom passed away a couple weeks ago, and so she is out of town this weekend to go for the memorial service. So be sure to hold Nancy Bolanzano and her husband, John, in your prayers. Filling in for her, we are able to welcome back Adriel Cruz. So we're so glad that Adriel's here to join us in filling in as our accompanist. Our liturgist this morning is Kathleen Mertoni, and she will lead us in our call to worship. So as you're able, please stand as you're able and join us in the call to worship and the gathering hymn.
Every generous act of giving is a tribute to God's love for us. Lord, be ready to listen and slow to react in anger. Lord, prepare us to be peaceful people. Keep your hearts and spirits ready to serve the Lord. Lord, open our hearts to hear and respond to your words of life in ministries of hope and peace. Amen.
Establish.
now hear these words from the book of James, chapter 1. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. He chose to give us birth through the word of truth, that we might be kind of first fruits of all he created. My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in a mirror and, after looking at himself, goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard, but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do. Those who consider themselves religious and yet do not keep a tight rein on their tongues deceive themselves, and their religion is worthless. Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. Our second scripture reading comes from the book of Mark, chapter 7. The Pharisees and some of the teachers of the law who had come from Jerusalem gathered around Jesus and saw some of his disciples eating food with hands that were defiled, that is, unwashed. The Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they give their hands a ceremonial washing, holding to the tradition of the elders. When they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash. And they observe many other traditions, such as the washing of cups, pitchers, and kettles. So the Pharisees and the teachers of the law asked Jesus, "Why don't your disciples live according to the tradition of the elders instead of eating their food with defiled hands?" He replied, "Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you hypocrites, as it is written, 'These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are merely human rules.' You have let go of the commands of God and are holding on to the human traditions." Again, Jesus called the crowd to him and said, "Listen to me, everyone, and understand this. Nothing outside a person can defile them by going into them. Rather, it is what comes out of a person that defiles them. For it was from within, out of a person's heart, that evil thoughts come: sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. All these evils come from inside and defile a person." The word of God for the people of God.
Let's pray. My gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread throughout the world abroad, the honors of thy name. Amen. Does anyone else just give a big ugh, when you, that big sigh, ugh, when you hear about the election? I know I do. The bombardment of political ads and pleas for money, the partisan mudslinging we witness on our screens, and the making of promises that I'm pretty sure we've heard before. I've had enough. Now, don't get me wrong. Politics are important and necessary in the life of a society. It's how we govern the affairs of our public life, and it depends on our participation. Martin and I even keep up with politics and often have lively debates over dinner. No, politics for me is not the problem. It's the politicians that make this season so unbearable. Now, I know politicians are human like everyone else, but I'm tired of seeing a politician say one thing and then go and vote in the opposite direction. Have you ever seen that before? Or when it comes to light that a politician did something that was contrary to who they said they were or what they said they stood for. Whew. I'm sure we can think of a few words for people like that. But the word for in our gospel reading for today is hypocrite. We are back in Mark's gospel, where we're picking up where we left off after our detour in John chapter 6 for the bread of life discourse. And as a reminder, where we are here in Mark chapter 7, Jesus has done many miracles at this point. He's healed the sick, he's cast out demons, he's sent out his disciples two by two to go do the same type of work, and we have just finished the feeding of the 5,000. So all eyes are on Jesus. All eyes, including the eyes of the religious authorities, are on Jesus and on his band of disciples. Here, the religious authorities notice something scandalous, something offensive, something intolerable. The disciples are eating without washing their hands. Having lived through pandemic times, I hope we all know and understand the benefits of washing our hands regularly. But that's not what the religious authorities are getting at or what they're concerned about. No, they are offended because the disciples are not walking according to the tradition of the elders. They are breaking ceremonial norms and expectations. For these religious authorities, eating with defiled hands meant the person would become defiled within. Unfazed, Jesus is able to see through their hypocrisy and quotes to them a scripture from the great prophet Isaiah. "These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching human precepts as doctrine." Then he says directly to them, "You abandon the commandment of God and hold on to human tradition." That is the offense that Jesus thinks should really cause us to be up in arms. It isn't about the disciples failing to wash their hands before a meal. It's about lifting up human tradition and man-made law to the level of God's word, wisdom, and ways. And then, in return, judging everyone when they fail to live up to those expectations. Their heart is in the wrong place. James, who many scholars believe was written by James, the brother of Jesus, would say that this type of religion was worthless. To clarify, he's not talking about the Jewish religion. No, the religion that is worthless is one that makes people think that they are holier than thou and allows for them to speak without any self-control. The religious authorities were on their high horse and they were quick to speak a word of judgment towards Jesus and his disciples. They are focused on outward appearances, on human tradition, and most of all, their self-righteousness. Do you know what that sounds like? I hate to say it, but that kind of sounds like church. How often do we hear about churches judging others or excluding others for not fitting into the mold? Or how often do we hear about churches that use secrecy to cover up their own abuses? Or how often do we hear about internal church fighting because there's change, either change in worship or change in leadership or any change at all? And you think politics is bad. Church politics? Oof. Lord have mercy. Friends, we need to do that internal check-in with our souls and with our hearts constantly, but especially in these moments of conflict. The old Methodist question, the question the early Methodists would ask one another when they met was, "How is it with your soul?" That's how we can determine if our religion is, as James put it, pure and undefiled, which means that it causes us to care for our neighbors and tend to our soul, or if our religion is worthless and self-seeking. To do this, we must internalize James' instruction. Let everyone be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to grow angry. Let's try that. Those are good words. Let's try that. Repeat after me. Quick to listen. Slow to speak.
Slow to speak.
Slow to grow angry.
Slow to grow angry.
That's the key. This is how we are able to set aside that moral filth, that evil intention, that hypocrisy, and that judgment within our hearts, and instead welcome the word that is able to save our souls. James warns, however, that there is a difference between hearing the word and internalizing it in such a way that we become, what he says, doers of the word. He writes this, "They are the ones who study the perfect law," not man's law, "the perfect law, the law of freedom, and continue to do it. They don't listen and forget like the hearers, but put into practice in their daily lives." What Jesus and his brother James are trying to get at is that inward transformation is necessary, that realigning of our heart is required, and that we must walk the talk. Now, don't leave here thinking that Jesus is anti-tradition or that Pastor Angel is anti-tradition. No, that's not the point. Outward signs are needed. Capital T traditions are important. They're grounding. They are what show us the way. The concern is when man-made rules distract us from hearing and, more importantly, doing the word. Continuing in our hypocrisy will only lead others further into disillusionment. I think that's why Christianity in America is experiencing so much decline. It's not so much that people don't believe in God or have faith anymore. It's because they don't believe or have faith in the church. And on a side note, I think that's also the same reason why many people choose not to vote. Many have become disillusioned. By failing to heed James' instruction to be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to grow angry, we become hyper-focused on outward appearances. And we miss out on the heart transformation that is needed to plant within us that religion that is pure and undefiled. We become, at the end, hypocrites, saying one thing not because of the word is transformative, but because it points out how others fall short. As a pastor, I strive to be involved in the larger community outside of the walls of the church, and I even try to meet with some of the local politicians. I believe it's important that we have some familiarity with one another, that I know a little bit of the issues and concerns around the city, and that the city knows that the church exists, that we are that we're a place of service. I've met with politicians in Marina, in Salinas, and now even here in Roseville. And I always do it with a little bit of skepticism when I go into a room with a politician. Often, they want to find a way to dump one of the city's problems on the church. Or, even though I've sent them many phone calls and emails and I never hear back, they're very quick to call me when they have a problem for me to fix. Or, worst of all, they happen to show up when it's election season. You know, I had that happen once. Easter Sunday, I had this candidate come with the world's largest campaign button. Never heard from them after that. There was one politician, however, that has stood out from the rest that I have met with and had the privilege to work with. His name is Mayor Bruce Delgado. He's the mayor of the city of Marina, and he is one who I would say walks the talk. Now, this isn't an endorsement of his politics. In fact, we don't share political affiliations. I remember when we first met over dinner, Mayor Delgado shared with me his passions and priorities as mayor, his personal commitments, and his deep love for the community. To a degree, it was kind of the same spiel we hear from other politicians, and I get that. But with time, I saw in him and his leadership someone who did not play the game of politics. In fact, he was actually bad at playing politics. I'd watch him on city council meetings, and sometimes he'd put his foot in his mouth. No, I saw in him someone who was fully converted by his philosophy and would use it as an unwavering guide for the way he lives and the way he governs. This man, I'm sure, was a hippie in his youth and now serves as a volunteer mayor of this small former military town. And I often would wonder, how did this guy get elected in this town? I think it's because he walks the talk. I'll never forget the pile of dirty dishes that he was piling up into the trunk of his Prius to take home and wash by hand after a citywide MLK Day event. The reason? He wouldn't allow for single-use plastic or paper products to be used by city events. I'll never forget, every weekend you would see him on his bike or in his Prius driving around town, organizing volunteers to clean up the dunes, to rehabilitate natural areas, and to even build community gardens. I'll never forget him riding his bike to our church's anniversary because he tried to avoid driving his car as much as possible. Now, there were other things that he did that I thought were just flat outrageous, but they were all consistent with his message. And I know that some people in town did not like him, and most people in town did not align with him politically. And yet, at the end of the day, he was who he said he was. Friends, we cannot allow ourselves to be distracted. We cannot allow ourselves to be divided, and we cannot continue to harm the witness of God's church. We need to be fully converted. We need to have a change of heart. We need to keep the main thing, and we need to walk the talk. This is hard work, but James has given us the key. Quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to grow angry. This is good instruction for us as individuals, as a congregation that's experiencing change, and for us in this election season. My friends, it's a good feeling to know that God has planted in us the word that gives life, a word that can guide us into perfect harmony and assist us in walking the talk, leaving behind our hypocritical ways. This is good news. Amen.
Lead me, Lord. Lead me by the hand and help me face the rising sun. Comfort me through all the pain that life may bring. There's no other hope that I can lean upon. Lead me, Lord. Lead me all my life. Walk by me. Walk by me across the lonely roads of every day. Take my arms and let your hand show me the way. Show the way to live inside your heart. Lead me, Lord. Lead me all my life. You are my light. You're the lamp upon my feet. All the time, my Lord, I need you. Lead me, Lord, even though at times I'd rather go along my way. Help me take the right direction, take your road. Lead me, Lord, and never leave my side. All my days, all my life, you are my light. You're the lamp upon my feet. All the time, my Lord, I need you there. the time, my Lord, I need you there. You are my light. I cannot live alone. Let me stay by your guiding love all through my life, all through my day. Lead me, Lord, all my life. Thank you, Jesus.
Friends, Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him. All who seek the way that leads to life, all who desire to follow the way of love. And I don't know about you, but sometimes I fall short in doing that. I fall short and I end up being a hypocrite like those religious authorities we talked about in the gospel reading for today. I focus in on these nitty-gritty details and lose sight of the big picture. Anyone else do that? Well, let us take a moment now in silence to maybe confess those times to God, to seek oneness with God and oneness with one another. And in a moment, I'll lead us in our prayer of confession. The words will be on the screen. But let's just take a moment to start. Let's pray this prayer together. O God of Shalom, we have built up walls to protect ourselves from our enemies, but these walls have also shut us from receiving your love. Break down those walls. Help us to see the way to your heart is through the reconciliation of our own hearts with our enemies. Bless them and us, that we may come to grow in love for each other and for you, through Jesus Christ. Amen. Through God's grace, we are forgiven by the mercy of our Creator, through the love of the Christ, and in the power of the Spirit, let us rejoice and be glad. Glory to God. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Blessed are you, our Alpha and Omega, whose strong and loving arms encompass the universe. For with your eternal Word and Holy Spirit, you are forever one God. Through your Word, you created all things and called them good. And in you, we live and move and are being. When we fell into sin, you did not desert us. You made covenant with your people and spoke through your prophets and teachers. In Jesus Christ, your word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth. And so with all creation and all the saints of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is Jesus Christ who called you Father. As a mother hen gathers her chicks under the care of her wings, you embraced a people as your own and filled them with a longing for peace that would last and for a justice that would never fail. In Jesus' suffering and death, you took upon yourself our sin and death and destroyed their power forever. You raised him from the dead, he who reigns with you in glory, and poured upon us the Holy Spirit, giving birth to your church. On the night in which Jesus was betrayed and arrested, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts, that in the breaking of this bread and the sharing of this cup, we may know the presence of the living Christ and be renewed as the body of Christ for the world, redeemed by your love. As the grain and grapes, once dispersed in the fields, are now united on this table in bread and cup, so may we and all your people be gathered from every time and place into the unity of your eternal home and feast at your table forever. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Let us pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the power of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. We pray this in the name and way of our brother Jesus. Amen. So there are announcements in your bulletin. Please make note of those, including that we are recruiting volunteers to help us with our new children's church. We're hoping to start at the end of September. So if you're interested in volunteering or be involved in some of the planning, we're kind of in the works right now. So we'd love to include and know how many folks we can count on. The goal is for us to offer children's church every other Sunday, the second and fourth Sunday of the month, so that we can then, one, ease into this new programming that we're offering our children, but also to give folks an opportunity to be here in worship also. We don't want folks to totally miss out on being part of worship as well. So if you're interested, please let me know or speak to Jan. We do require that all of our volunteers with children go through the Safe Gatherings Training, which is a child and elder abuse prevention program. Our evening prayer will resume this week, but please note that it's going from Tuesday to Wednesday, and it'll be the same time and on Zoom. Next Sunday, the choir will resume, so we're excited to welcome back the choir and Eleanor. Has anyone else missed Eleanor? I've missed Eleanor. And so Eleanor will be back from Costa Rica, I think, sometime this week. She should be. She's going to be here for choir on Sunday. So if you're interested in joining the choir and lending your voice to be part of this joyful noise, rehearsal will be at 8:30 here in the sanctuary, and all are welcome. There's no auditions here, okay? So we'll let everyone in. And then the choir will perform on second and fourth Sunday of the month. Next Sunday, I will be out of town. I shared this in the past, I was accepted into the Academy of Spiritual Formation, which has these cohorts for spiritual renewal. And so I'll be going away for about 5 days in Chicago to go answer that question, how is it with my soul? We talked about that Methodist question. So I'm going to do that internal time for me. And so I'm going to be largely unavailable. If you have a pastoral care matter, or if there's something about the church you have a question about, feel free to talk to one of our lay leaders. So I'm going to have our lay leaders wave their hands. Okay, we got three. We're very lucky to have three in this church. Sometimes it's hard for a church to have just one. But we have three great lay leaders, and if there is a urgent pastoral care concern where a pastor is needed, they will call upon Pastor Ginger Foster, who serves our church up in Auburn. She'll be covering pastoral care concerns. Preaching next Sunday will be the Reverend Jerry Ango, who is a former pastor here, and so he's very excited to be here on that Sunday. Lastly, we will be receiving new members on the 15th of September. So if you're interested in making First Church your official home, come talk to me, talk to one of our lay leaders. We'll talk to you a little bit about, you know, answer questions about the church, about United Methodism, whatever you want, and we'll connect with you there. Yes, something about directories? Oh, okay, there are directories printed, so if you're a member and would like a directory, we have some. You can also talk to Nancy Bray, and we'll get you a copy of the directory. Also, just to note this week is that with Labor Day, the church office will be closed on Monday. So the church office will be open Wednesday and Friday this week, but the new standard will be Mondays and Wednesdays, same time, 9 to noon. Let us pray. Lord, we want to be more like Jesus in our hearts. We ask, God, that you would send your Holy Spirit to nudge us into that direction, to let go of that natural tendency to judge others, to think more of ourselves, to have maybe bad intention. Nudge us away from that. And help us to welcome with open arms the word that leads to life. God, we ask that your Spirit would empower us to be doers of this word so that folks around us can know, especially those who are in most need, that Jesus has sent us. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Well, before we sing Shalom, remember that we have refreshments in Beckman Hall. So I please join us for refreshments and for fellowship. This is an extension of our service so that we can grow in community. So let's sing together Shalom.